Procedures and Public Appointments Committee, good morning. This is the 22nd meeting of this year. Our first item today is for the committee to take evidence on the Scottish Parliament Elections etc. Miscellaneous Amendments Order 2020. And joining us today we have the Minister Graham Day, Minister for Parliamentary Business and Veterans, and with him are his officials Roddy Angus and Ian Hockenhull. Right. Oh, and Ewan McCaig, beg your pardon, Ewan is here. Right. I would now like to ask the Minister if he'd like to make a short opening statement, please.
Convener, good morning. Thank you for the opportunity to set out the Government's position on the Scottish Parliament Elections etc. Miscellaneous Amendments Order 2020, which is before you today. The order makes a number of changes to the rules and procedures for the running of the Scottish Parliament elections. It builds on those which were in place for the last general election in May 2016, which is widely regarded as having been run successfully. A number of these changes are technical and reflect the transfer of competence for electoral registration at Scottish Parliament elections from the UK Parliament to the Scottish Parliament, as was set out in the Scotland Act 2016. These changes do not affect how the election will be run. They simply move the existing requirements from UK legislation into Scottish legislation. The May 2021 election will also mark the first time that everyone who has leave to remain in Scotland will be able to vote at a Scottish Parliament election. This is an important change and will rightly ensure that everyone who's chosen to live in Scotland will be able to have a say on matters which affect them. It is, of course, impossible to think about the election next May without considering how the coronavirus pandemic may impact that election. However, in relation to your consideration today, Convener, I should be clear that apart from extending the right to an emergency proxy vote to those who may be unable to attend the polling station in person due to COVID-19, this order does not make any other changes specifically relating to the pandemic. As you know, this committee is currently considering the Scottish General Election Coronavirus Bill, and it's our intention to bring forward further secondary legislation to set out how any changes which are agreed by the Parliament in that bill are to be implemented in practice. To include them in this order, Kavira, would have required us to anticipate the will of the Parliament. I hope that you agree that the order sets out sensible rules for the running of the Scottish Parliamentary election next May. And I and my officials will be happy to answer any questions the committee have, though given the very technical nature of the order, I will likely be relying heavily on my colleagues.
Right, thank you very much for your honesty, Minister. Okay, so I would now like to invite questions from members, please. And the first question coming in blue jeans, I believe, is Patrick Harvey, co-convener. Patrick.
Thank you very much, Convener. I wonder if the Minister could just lay out a little more about the exemptions from expenditure limits and the evidence that will need to be provided to substantiate those exemptions.
Okay, so if I could offer some examples, perhaps. Say a constituency has a large community of a certain nationality. The candidate translates a leaflet into the appropriate language so that that sector of the community is aware of their views. The cost of translation would not count towards the expenditure limit, but the cost of printing the leaflets would still be a cost, as would be the case for the English version. Let's say a candidate receives requests from a number of blind voters for a Braille version of their campaign leaflet. The cost of providing the Braille leaflet does not count towards the expenditure limit. And if, for example, a candidate was to invite a controversial individual to speak at an event, at hustings, whatever, in the constituency, and there were legitimate concerns about the possibility of a risk of violence at the event, and it might be prudent, therefore, to employ security for that possibility, the cost of security doesn't count towards the expenditure limits. And in terms of evidencing this, the Electoral Commission prepares guidance and advice for candidates on how that should be progressed.
Thank you. And will there be or would there be any impact on candidate expenditure limits if the election was postponed under the terms of the the coronavirus election bill?
That is the subject of ongoing discussion, Mr. Harvey, with the Electoral Commission. And I guess it would depend on the length of the postponement. If it was a postponement of a day or a few days, then I think it would be reasonable to suggest not. But if we got into the territory of 5.5 weeks plus, perhaps, then that's a different matter.
Thank you.
So, okay, Patrick, thank you very much indeed for that. Okay, if we can move on. I don't know, Maureen, do you? Maureen's just around.
Thank you.
Right, Maureen, if you'd like to ask question number two, please. Thank you.
So, as you said, Minister, that we're, as a committee, are currently considering the coronavirus bill. This proposes that the date of dissolution be moved to the day before the election on the 6th of May so that Parliament can meet if there's an emergency. Can you explain what arrangements are for candidates' expenditure limits if the poll is postponed by further legislation?
So can I bring Roddy in on that? Do you mean in the context of what we've just touched upon with Mr. Harvey, if there's a short delay or if there's a much longer delay?
So if we move the date of the dissolution to the day before the election day so that we can meet an emergency session if necessary, are there different arrangements for candidates' expenditure limits if the poll is postponed further past the 6th of May?
Substantially postponed.
Yeah.
Ian,
well,
do you want to
even any. Because, you know, everybody wants to put out an eve of poll letter or a last-minute leaflet in the last week, so...
I think the short answer to that is it would depend on the length of the any postponement. Do you want to expand on that, Ian?
Essentially, yes. So the length of the delay would be a factor, but we're in discussion with the Electoral Commission about how we would approach that and would take their advice on what would be required. And there's provision already to make any necessary changes by secondary legislation, so it wouldn't need to be in the bill itself.
Okay, the other bill. Okay, right.
Can I just ask on top of that, thanks Maureen, can I just ask, are you in discussion with the political parties how this is going to go as well? I mean, on the basis that they've got to prepare, you know, going ahead, going forward?
Well, without question, there will be discussion with the political parties, but we would need to receive the advice of the Electoral Commission to form the basis of those discussions. Because what we've done with the process of that bill, as you know, Convener, is work very closely with all of the electoral authorities and the professionals and the parties. But in the first instance, we would want some guidance from the Electoral Commission on their views on the best way to proceed.
Okay, well, that makes sense. Thank you very much for that then. And could we ask Jamie if you'd like to ask a third question, please?
I can do, yes. In relation to the publication of the opportunity to inspect expenditure returns, it's now at the discretion of the returning officer. How is the transparency of the process guaranteed by the changes proposed?
The transparency of the process of being able to inspect the...
Yeah.
So this is not about removing the option of advertising through newspapers, as is currently the case. This is about devolving the judgment to local circumstance where the relevant authority will make a decision about the best means possible. We all know that newspaper circulation has fallen dramatically over the last few years. And it may be, in a particular circumstance, there is still a local newspaper that's considered to be the best method of getting that out there. There may be other means. But of course, every election agent, whatever methodology is used to publicise this, every election agent will continue to receive individual notification of the time and the place for inspecting expenditure returns. And there is an expectation that the returning officer will make every effort to make that information available in a wider sense. But we are entrusting that to them.
Okay. Do you want me to cover question four as well, Convener?
If you've got something on that, yes.
Thanks very much. It's a very technical one. Regards to the minimum type size for the imprint, which sets out the details of the printer and the like. You'll be very aware of that. I was just wondering, how has decisions on that been come about, and what consideration have they been given to those who perhaps, obviously, either are blind or hard of seeing?
Yeah, it's a difficult one because there was the Electoral Commission had a view, the political parties have a view. There was consideration given to merely referencing legibility, but that's very subjective. So we tried to strike the right balance between delivering legibility but ensuring there was legibility, if you get my point. So we have gone for at least 9 point in Times New Roman for smaller than A4. I'm thinking about survey cars, that type of thing, and anything above that is 11 point. We think that strikes the balance between providing a readable imprint and not going to excess, particularly on the smaller materials. And we've asked the Electoral Commission to monitor the success or otherwise of that approach. With regard to visual impairment and that's an interesting point. I'm going to bring in one, Ian on that, or Roddy, or maybe not.
I'm not sure. Do you have anything, Roddy?
Well, basically, with visual impairment, it depends on the element of visual impairment. You've got people that no matter what the size of the imprint would be, they wouldn't be able to see it, but they're unlikely to be trying to read a printed document in any case. They are more likely to go to the computer, where it can be, a document can be blown up. Similarly, any imprint can be enlarged so that they can read it. The imprint size of most printed documents is based on the premise that most people have reasonable eyesight and can read it. For example, I wear glasses. One of the tests I used was I printed something out with 9 point, took my glasses off, and could I read it at a reasonable distance holding it there? I could. So, we tried it with different sizes to see how close you could read it or not. But as the Minister said, we realise that this is not a perfect solution, and we've asked the Electoral Commission to specifically monitor it and to bring any concerns to us that are raised with them about this issue. Previously, there was absolutely no restriction on the size of an imprint, and there have been cases where it was so small that it was difficult for people to read it at all. But the argument was there is an imprint on the document, therefore we comply with the law. What we've said is it must be of at least a certain size.
I think we've probably all been in the position where we've been searching around on leaflets to try and find an imprint, which is there, but it's almost like a kind of test to find it. I just wonder whether actually in the future, and this is not necessarily related to this, but in the future, given that people who are visual impairment will also get leaflets coming through their door like anybody else, then there maybe has to be some sort of QR code on every leaflet. And I don't want to create problems for everybody, so that information can be, can link into something online for those that perhaps have a difficulty seeing. Not just the imprint, but actually the whole information on that leaflet. It might be something to think of for the future. Anyway.
I think you make a fair point. And as this committee is aware, we have an ongoing dialogue with the visually impaired community in particular, and they're not slow to make suggestions, which is really useful. So that's something for us to bear in mind going forward.
Thank you. Because of the technicalities of that, we weren't sure if we were going to be asking you that question, but it actually brought forward quite a bit of detail, so that was worthwhile. Thank you very much. Neil Finlay? Oh, sorry, beg your pardon, Roddy.
No, I was just going to say, if I could add on that, there is actually nothing to stop parties doing that already. They could put on their own QR codes. It's just whether we want to actually legislate to make that mandatory might be an issue, but there is nothing to stop political parties or candidates using that system as it is.
OK. Okay, thank you. Thanks, Roddy. Neil, could you kick off question five for us, please?
Yeah, it's really about the how the order impacts on the cost and practicalities of any postponement of the poll.
So I think I'd go back to what I said earlier. The question is, how long is a poll delayed for? Whether it's a matter of days, a matter of weeks, or longer. In the first instance, our intention is to allow the returning officer to reuse any material that's already been printed with the original date of the poll on it, where that's possible. That will reduce the cost of a postponed election. It's about a common sense approach. We wouldn't want to waste money where it's avoidable. I think that's probably the general answer I would give to you. Do you have particular aspects of this that you want to explore?
So, if, for example, if the poll's delayed, I mean, most stuff has a date on it. So does that get pulped and we start again, or do we continue on the basis that...
Not if that's avoidable, Mr. Finlay. So if, let's say, the date on the ballot paper. If you were, for example, to be rescheduling a poll within, let's say, 3 weeks, it would not be possible, nor would it be desirable, to reprint all the ballot papers in that period. So what we're looking to have is the flexibility that we still use the ballot paper with the original date on it. But of course, if you get into the territory of a much more extended period, then of course the option is there to change the date on the ballot paper as an example. So this is about having flexibility to take a common sense approach to the situation.
Just reflecting on recent elections across the water and wondering whether wrong dates on things might open up a whole legal can of worms.
Well, touch wood, I think in Scotland we've generally got a history of running elections quite efficiently, certainly set against events across the pond. But I want to bring one of the guys and maybe give you a bit more detail on what that this will look like in practice. Ian, do you want
to? One point to make is that this order is amending the law as it stands at present. So it amends the Scotland Act Section 2, which will then be amended by the Coronavirus Bill. So at the moment, the provisions in relation to reusing materials envisage the presiding officer being able to postpone the election by up to 1 month. And it doesn't take account of the change to 6 months in the bill, because that's not law yet. So once this order's through and the bill is through, and you are envisaging a postponement, we'd have to make a tweak to the references in order to allow that to carry over further. But as the further you get away from the election by more than a month, you probably need to reissue materials to avoid that level of confusion. This is really about another event other than coronavirus leading to a postponement by only a few days, and to save the waste. And people should hopefully be aware, oh, it was the 6th of May, it's now the 11th of May, and make that calculation in their heads.
But I'm assuming the you know, electoral lawyers and the constitutional lawyers have looked at this and said this is all okay. Okay. I'm glad I've just asked that question on the record.
Thank you very much for that. And Gil Paterson, please.
Thanks very much, Convener. Can I take you to the number of counting agents? And the order amends the provision relating to the minimum number of counting agents who have to be appointed by the returning officer. So therefore, can you explain the rationale behind the proposal to set a minimum number of counting agents per individual candidate and party?
So this is about addressing a slight anomaly and ensuring fairness of treatment. So the current position is that there's no minimum number of counting agents which the returning officer must allow, as long as each candidate has the same maximum number. So what the change does, it sets out that the returning officer must now allow at least the same number of counting agents as there are counting clerks, and that each candidate and party must be allowed the same number of counting agents. That's already the position at other elections. That's what I mean by the anomaly. So, for example, if there was 125 counting clerks at a count and there are five candidates standing, then each candidate must be allowed to have at least 25 counting agents. That's the lower limit. The returning officer may allow more than this as a maximum limit if they wanted to. But of course, there's also has to be flexibility here for the returning officer, bearing in mind social distancing needs in the current situation. And of course, they also have the flexibility to recognise that perhaps one candidate will not require 25 in those circumstances. So this is about delivering consistency of approach across elections, but still giving the returning officer a degree of flexibility.
I'm trying to get my head down. I can do the maths, but I can't do the physics, physical presence with that number of people if there's a constrained space.
Absolutely.
So is there a limit to that number that is in the hands of the people in control at the count?
The limit is set by dividing the deliverable number by the number of candidates.
But not by the space that...
Oh, no, the space is absolutely... I mean, that's just an example I'm giving you about it was 125. Now, we all know there are counting venues where you could have more. There'd be others where you couldn't have anything like it. It would be up to the returning officer, and it would be demonstrably fair because they would be able to explain how they arrived at that number.
So it would be a division of the space. Division of the... In this case.
Counting clerks do you have? Therefore, how many counting agents would you have, and how would that be divvied up, if that makes sense?
But coronavirus
has an impact on that. So there are special circumstances where the returning officer could clearly say it is not possible to deliver this. Therefore, the combined limit is X, and therefore this is the division of the number of counting agents.
Yeah, that's the point I was getting to, because in normal circumstances, sky was the limit, and you could fit in as many as you like, mm-hmm. more or less. But coronavirus will determine it because of the space rather than the maths.
Yeah, or any other circumstances that's required in the view of the returning officer.
Right, okay, thanks for that, Mr. Yep, good answer, thank you. Yep.
Well, thank you very much for that. I've got a couple of questions that I've got a link to them. So, John, could you ask questions 7 and 8, please?
Okay, thank you, convener. Can I ask you about emergency proxies, please, Minister? The order introduces a new category of eligibility for an emergency proxy, one which is sought after 5 p.m. on the sixth day before the poll. In these circumstances, with the final decision resting with the ERO, this proposal is time limited, ceasing to come into effect 2 years after coming into force. So how will awareness be raised among voters of the potential to request an emergency proxy vote and the procedure for so doing?
Yeah, it's a very good question. It kind of touches on an area we covered last week about the circumstances that might arise where an individual is requiring to have an alternative means of voting. So every elector who's not registered for an absent vote will get their polling card. That will include information that if after 5 p.m. on the Tuesday, a week before the poll, they are unable to vote in person, then they can apply for a proxy vote. The card will provide a helpline number through which electors can obtain the help and the information they need. You'll also have the Electoral Commission website, and certainly most, if not all, council websites providing that information and how they can apply for proxy votes. And clearly, that will form part of the narrative of the election as an option as well.
Right. Thank you very much. Which sort of takes you on to the next question, and it's about standardising the deadline for replacement of spoilt or lost ballot papers. And from whom can voters seek a replacement of a lost or spoilt postal ballot, and how will they be made aware again of this provision and the 10 p.m. deadline, which has now been moved from 5 p.m. to 10 p.m.
Okay, so again, it involves the polling card. Every elector who's registered for a postal vote will receive a postal voter's poll card And on that will be information that if they, it'll tell them that they would receive their postal vote by a certain date. If they haven't received it, it'll provide a phone helpline for them to call to query that. Every postal voter polling card will include information as well that makes clear that if the voter loses or spoils the ballot paper, they can phone that helpline and that a replacement can be issued up to 10 p.m. on the day of the poll. In addition to that, each postal ballot pack will have information that if the voter makes a mistake or loses their ballot paper or postal voting statement, then they should phone the helpline and replacements can and will be issued before 10 p.m. on the day of the poll. So there's a double sort of hit there of information.
And while I confess I haven't thought about this at all, but there's no potential there for fraud. There's safeguards in place for people not voting twice in those circumstances.
Okay, I'll bring Rory in to provide you some assurance on that.
There, if you have spoilt your ballot paper or lost part of your postal ballot pack, you will be asked to bring the remaining documentation with you to the returning officer so the returning officer can check that that's all there. They will take that off you, reissue you with a new one. If it has not turned up at all, then a new ballot pack will be issued and the old ballot pack, which is numbered, that number will be highlighted on the returning officer systems, and if a vote has been cast using that ballot pack, it will not be counted. So there's a double check to make sure that if you're physically returning it, you've got the documentation. If it's not there at all, the original ballot pack is cancelled and a new ballot pack is issued. The returning officer may also ask if there's any uncertainty about the identity, they may request proof of identity from the individual as well, if they have concerns that it might not be a legitimate request.
Okay, right, thanks very much.
Thanks very much, John. Maureen, do you got a follow-up there?
Yes, just on John's first question in terms of needing an emergency postal or proxy vote because you have to self-isolate. Is there any way that you have to prove that you have to self-isolate, or is it just taking people on their word that they're not able to go to the polling station?
I should clarify something on this as well, and I'll bring Rory in to provide you some more detail. This isn't just about the individual who may be required to self-isolate. If you have a carer in your household, for example, then that individual can legitimately request a proxy vote, and there is no attestation process around this as well. But do you want to come in on that, Rory, on the original point?
As the Minister said, there is no attestation requirement, so there is no actual proof required that you have to self-isolate or are shielding, because how can you prove that you're having to self-isolate? However, the electoral registration officer will be aware of the risks in their particular area due to coronavirus. Similarly, they will also be monitoring requests for proxy votes, and if they think that the numbers being requested are excessive compared to the prevalence of coronavirus in their area, then they may undertake further investigations.
Okay. Thank you. Thanks very much. And Jamie, you had something?
Just going back to that, the points being made there. I mean, we're talking about late timescales. What further investigations could they be doing that prevent people voting? I mean, you know, the whole nature of proxy voting is that it's relatively last minute. I mean, for example, a household could quite legitimately, if one member is having to self-isolate, all have to self-isolate, which could be five people, all needing a proxy vote, and there wouldn't be time to necessarily to, or there's likely not to be time for a registration officer who is going to be at a very busy time anyway to investigate a case like this. It does sound a little bit that there aren't perhaps safeguards there, that, you know, there's a lot of trust and reliance on people just being able to turn around and say, I mean, obviously, they would have had to be pre-registered for a vote anyway. I do appreciate that, but that's one issue. I mean, they wouldn't be able to probably investigate given timescales and workload at the time. And
we are in the business of facilitating people voting and encouraging that. So yeah, there is an element of trust in this and a belief that it's the system isn't going to be abused. Mm. But we are in a particular set of circumstances where we have to take particular measures.
Yeah. Well, that moves kind of onto the kind of main point the question I wanted to ask. I mean, we've talked a lot about postal ballots, the capacity to be able to process postal ballots, given the increased demand. So again, going back to the timescales for proxy voting, for if there was either a surge in demand just before the election, a few days before the election, because of whatever reasons, potentially because there's been an outbreak in a certain area, what additional capacity are EROs being advised to put in place, or are they putting in place, or is that being left for them to decide?
If I could respond to that, EROs have already faced the circumstances at the 2014 independence referendum. The rules for applying for a proxy were laxer or more lax than they currently are, and there was a large number of late applications. What most electoral registration officers did in that situation was they pulled in staff from their other parts of their organisation, because they are assessors. So they pulled staff off the assessment side and put them onto the electoral registration side in order to process applications, check them, enter them, etc. We would always advise them to do similar. They prepare their plans. They are aware of this possibility of a late increase in postal vote applications, late increase in proxy applications. They know that is a possibility, and they will be making contingency plans to prepare for that eventuality.
On that basis, can I ask possibly an unfair question that you won't be able to answer? And if you don't, I'll accept that. But in that 2014 independence referendum, and on a standard normal election in normal times, is there a considerable percentage of proxy votes that simply aren't requests for a proxy vote that are rejected or aren't able to be processed?
Normally, proxy votes would only be rejected or if they are not made on grounds that are allowed. Mm-hmm. You know, there are certain grounds on which you can apply for a proxy vote, which is why we've had to change it to include shielders and self-isolators. Normally, rejections would be on those grounds. As the Minister said, electoral registration officers will tend to give the benefit of the doubt to the voter unless they have concerns. Examples might be if they were, say, to get 10 applications for a proxy from one household on the basis that they all happen to be attending a course that day. Now, that would raise concerns with the electoral registration officer, and he would carry out further checks. You know, it's down to reasonableness, and electoral registration officers know their area, they know the size of households in that area, and will take that into account when considering applications.
It's also worth being clear, I think, as we touched on last week, there are two processes going on here in preparation for the election. There is the one that we all directly engaged in with the legislation preparation. There's also extensive work being done by the Electoral Management Board and the EROs and the returning officers to prepare for this. So the practical, the nuts and the bolts work is going on as well. And we trust those individuals who know the running of elections inside out to be on top of that process.
Oh, no, I absolutely appreciate that. And I recognise that these elections are going to take place in a very difficult time. But obviously, when we're looking, what they're being asked to deliver, it's obviously our responsibility to try and ensure that we're looking at some of the problems that might arise, because, you know, there are going to be great pressures on a lot of people running into the election, people who already in election processes are under pressure just in the nature of elections. So I think it's important to kind of make sure that some of these points are being covered.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. Thanks for that, Jamie. Okay, now look, we've got a wee bit of time. Not very much actually has to be said, but is there any other question that any members have that they really want to get out? Gil first and then Neil. Thanks.
Yeah, it's in regards to the printing of the party name on the regional ballot papers. If I could ask that the order makes provision for the printing of the names on political parties in capital letters, as well as a range of other provisions that will alter the arrangements for the administration of the election. What form did your consultation take of the various stakeholders, and were you content with the level of engagement from the bodies consulted? Somebody's just checking to make sure I'm asking the question right. Sorry about that. My apologies.
I'm glad that wasn't me. So the requirement for party names to be printed in capitals is simply clarifying existing practice. The example ballot paper Form J in the 2015 order showed party names in capitals, but the printing instructions didn't specify that requirement. So this change aligns the example and the actual required printing directions. So what's happened here in terms of developing this order is that since the last Scottish Parliament election in 2016, the Scottish Government's had kept a record of possible changes that would require to be made to the conduct order. And that was informed by recommendations to the Electoral Commission and by comments and suggestions from electoral administrators and others, including political parties. So this was all brought together through that process. In early 2020, Scottish Government officials met with the electoral administrators, the Commission, to discuss the list of possible changes. There was further consultation carried out with these bodies, carried out by correspondence. The government then wrote to stakeholders, including the political parties, in mid-August of this year, to inform them of the changes which we were proposing to make to the administrative arrangements for running the election. Now, unfortunately, as you can imagine, Mr. Patterson, since March 2020, the interactions have not been of a normal nature because of the pandemic. There's been disruption with, as we know, people working from home, etc., etc. But to all intents and purposes, we have made everyone that's involved in this aware of the proposed changes. There's been an opportunity for feedback, and what's before you today ultimately is where we have arrived at. There has been, and I stand to be corrected by officials, but there's been no particular concerns raised about the content of the order. The order reflects expectations and asks that we had in preparation for the next elections.
So it's more administrative.
It is very much so. It's a very, very technical order, as you have realised.
It's for the running of it. Yeah, yeah. I understand. That's fair. Yeah. Thank you for that.
Thank you very much indeed. Neil Finlay, please.
An associated sort of question, just whilst you're here, Minister, in relation to the potential postponement of the election. Presumably, in those circumstances, if the election was going to be postponed, the government would approach the presiding officer and there would be that discussion that would take place. Presumably that would involve the government having legal advice. In those circumstances, if the election was going to be postponed and there was that advice, would in those circumstances legal advice be published?
It would be self-evident, Mr. Finlay, that there was a need to postpone the election. There would... It's not something that would be done lightly. It would be a set of circumstances. And elections can be postponed for reasons other than pandemics, as we know. We have had a very open and transparent process of finding a way forward in this. So how would it work in practice? All parties would have legal advice. The presiding officer would have advice around the position. The government would have advice. Political parties would have advice. And you would develop the discussions to the point where the presiding officer would be asked to take a view of whether or not such a recall of Parliament was necessary. So I don't think getting into the territory of who has legal advice and would they publish it, would be the government publish, would the presiding officer, is particularly relevant. The circumstances would be crystal clear, and no one, no participant in this process, it would be operating out with the bounds of what was appropriate.
Yeah, I accept all of that. And, you know, if we bear in mind, I'm not having a go at MD over this. I'm asking about the principle of this. This would be a monumentous decision to delay an election. You know, it would be a huge decision.
Parliament.
Yeah, but it might be a controversial decision. There might be opposition to it. So it would be in the interest of democracy that the rationale behind that was in the public domain.
And the rationale would be in the public domain, very clearly in the public domain.
And the legality of it in the public domain.
I think it would be self-evident that no government, no presiding officer, no parliament would be acting in a way that was out with the appropriate. I hope that answers your mischievous question.
No, it doesn't really, because we've seen other parliaments, 600 miles away, the government acting illegally. There is precedent for this, but I accept you're not going to answer my question.
Right, thanks. Thank you very much. Thanks, Minister. John, you had something just in the back of that, and we'll go to Patrick.
Well, I had. From the discussion with Neil Findlay, Minister, can I now take it the position is that the government has conceded that this would be a vote of Parliament rather than just a discussion with the presiding officer. If there was Scottish ministers thought that they were going to postpone an election, this would actually be a vote of Parliament that would decide that, rather than just previously a discussion with the presiding officer.
Well, the whole point of the approach in the bill not dissolving Parliament but going into a recess is to afford the opportunity for the MSPs to come back on vote in this. That's very clearly in the bill. So that those are the circumstances, because this is not a decision to be taken lightly.
But in that regard, if the discussion that you would have with the presiding officer and the legal advice that he took disagreed with the legal advice that the Scottish Government took and their reasons for wanting to postpone an election, how would that matter be resolved?
But this isn't. I need to be clear about the circumstances here. We expect the election to go ahead as planned. No one is looking to postpone the election. There would have to be a set of very, very self-evident circumstances where there would be a consensus across the Parliament. And remember, in the circumstances we are talking about, the presiding officer, if I recall correctly, consults various bodies, including the chief medical officer, for example, before the presiding officer decides that it's appropriate to recall Parliament, to ask Parliament to consider making that decision. So there is a very clear process in place here, one I would hope that the committee would accept is the right way to proceed here. We are trying to ensure, one, this decision is not taken lightly. Two, it's not the government's decision, it's the Parliament's decision. The presiding officer makes a decision to recall Parliament, and then Parliament votes.
That's perfect. Thanks very much.
Okay, thank you very much for that. And Patrick Harvey, please. Thank you.
Thank you. We're in danger of turning this into supplementary evidence on last week's session. Just coming back to the order, your opening remarks mentioned the fact that this is the first election where the franchise will be based on residency rather than citizenship. As you know, that's something I very much welcome. I wonder if you can just say whether that factor has influenced any of the contents of the order. Does the fact that we need to now not only administer but also promote the take-up of the right to vote by a great many more international visitors, international students, for example, who might not be here for very long, has that influenced anything that's in the order, or is there anything that's taking place outside of the order to undertake the promotion of awareness of that that opportunity people will have vote for the first time?
It's a very good question, Mr. Harvey, and I will pass over to my expert, Roddy Angus.
The only thing in the order that could be seen as being impacted on this, and it's not specifically for that, is the removal of translation costs from within expenditure limits. However, that was not the particular reason. The extension of the franchise was not the particular reason for that change. There's nothing in the order about that. However, electoral registration officers have been undertaking work within their local areas to encourage foreign nationals who are now eligible to vote to take advantage of that during the canvass. That was done. Similarly, the Electoral Commission in the run-up to the election will be emphasising the change of canvass in their television and other adverts that we will all have seen. They will be encouraging reminding foreign nationals that they are now entitled to the vote and encouraging them to register. So while there's not any particular issue or particular changes in this order, work is being undertaken outside that.
Thank you very much.
Just to say that the Electoral Commission have actually got a custom campaign called Welcome to Your Vote, which they've been running and are continuing to run, and it involves a number of advertising aspects, stakeholder resources, educational resources, and they've also got some updated forms for prisoners who have also had the franchise extended to them.
Thank you very much. Is that okay, Patrick? Yep. Thank you very much for that. Okay, everyone. Pardon me. I would like to thank the Minister and the officials for that detailed and very useful advice and evidence. So we'll move on to agenda item 2, which the Minister will remain present for. And I'd like to invite the Minister to move and speak to motion S5M23119 in his name, that the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee recommends that the Scottish Parliament elections, etc., Miscellaneous Amendments Order 2020 be approved. Okay, Minister.
Given the workload of the committee today, I'll constrain myself to simply moving the order.
Okay. So you don't have to say anything further at the moment. Would any committee members like to speak regarding the motion? Nope. Thank you. Okay, the question then is that motion S5M23119 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you, Pta. And so the motion is agreed to. And can I confirm that members are content for me to sign off the committee's report on this order?
Content.
And I do. And thank you. And that ends the public part of the meeting. I'd like to thank the Minister and the officials. Thank you all very much indeed. That's very kind. We'll see you at another point, no doubt, anyway, but thank you. Next week.